stroke happens when the blood supply to the brain is cut off. And when brain cells don't get their oxygen and their blood flow, they die rapidly within minutes. It's what I call a FedEx nightmare. You have 100 billion customers, and if you're 2 minutes late, they all die. Once somebody with a suspected stroke is taken to UC Irvine Medical Center, we have what we call the brain attack code. As soon as the emergency room nurse or doctor suspects that it's a stroke, a member of our stroke service is in the ER waiting or arrives within 5 minutes.
As soon as patient arrives in the emergency room, the patient will be evaluated by both emergency team and the stroke neurologist. Within 5 minutes, we will make a decision to send the patient to have a CT scan. If CT scan shows the evidence of possible ischemic stroke, patient will receive acute therapy, including medical therapy and or thrombectomy.
In this image, you can see a before and after image of a thrombectomy procedure for a stroke patient. In this first image, you can see blockage of a large vessel in the back part of the brain. The clot was removed, the vessel was opened up.
What follows from somewhere around day one, two, or three until somewhere around 1 or 2 months, maybe more, is a period where the brain is galvanized for repair. The brain is on fire, ready for the right kinds of growth factors or stem cells or stimulation or therapy or practice. The brain is chemically and cellularly optimized to be responsive to certain kinds of interventions. One really fertile area for activity-dependent plasticity has been robotics.
I am interested in making robotic devices that can help people relearn how to move after they've had a neurologic injury like a stroke or a spinal cord injury. You have your brain and it's used to being able to talk to muscles a certain way. You have a stroke and now that way is gone. Okay, but your brain has a lot of redundant pathways in it and has also the ability to form new connections. And so what we think is when you enable a person to practice a lot, it's essentially like a search. They're like searching for that new pathway to be able to talk to the muscle again. And so I think our devices really enable people to search more effectively for the pathways that are going to work for them to recover. We've made about 20 to 30 devices in my lab over the last 15 years. And what we're trying to do is give technologies that can help people practice a lot of movement. One thing our exoskeletons do is they assist people in moving. So they simply allow people to start practice moving. The devices are usually connected to a video game to try to make it more engaging. But simply being able to move again is very motivating.
With individuals with brain injuries and stroke, we actually bring them into the studio and we do different types of phrases with them and give them feedback. And we can use dance as a modality to help that neuroplasticity, those plastic changes that happen after injury, to improve their function. Dance is multimodal, right? So you're not only moving, but you have the socialization that's really important. In addition, lots of research has been published about the use of music and how motivating that is to participate in a rehab strategy.
Research on brain diseases is a team effort. It involves the community, it involves patients and physicians, it involves the people who work in hospitals and clinics. It involves the families of the patients. It involves everybody working together. And we at UC Irvine are committed to providing patients with the very best care possible.